Good evening, everyone. I'm Jennifer Steinhauer, Director of Speaker Series at the Institute of Politics. We're pleased to welcome you tonight to a discussion about former Mayor, Chicago Mayor Harold Washington. Before one of our students formally introduces our guests, I just want to mention a couple upcoming events we have at IOP and go over a couple housekeeping notes. Tomorrow, April 28th, the IOP will host former U.S. Senator Al Franken, Minnesota Democrat, for an evening of comedy. That will take place at Ida Noyes, and that will begin at 5:30. On May 4th, we will have former South Bend Mayor, former presidential candidate, and current U.S. Department of Transportation Secretary Pete Buttigieg, and he'll participate in a student-led discussion, and that will be here at the Rubenstein Forum. And on May 16th, former Illinois Department of Public Health Director Ngozi Nziki and Thomas Fisher, a UC Chicago emergency room physician and author of The Emergency, will discuss how health officials and medical providers can rebuild trust in the healthcare system. And that will take place over the Quad Club. So after today's moderated discussion, we will open the floor to take questions from you in the audience. Please stay in your seat, raise your hand, and wait for our moderator to call on you. Masks are optional for students when asking questions per the university's latest guidelines. And as usual, we will give priority for the first questions to be asked by our students. So please make sure your phones are on silent. And before I introduce our student speaker, I wanted to also acknowledge the filmmakers, Joe Winston, Raymond Lambert, and Bob Hercules, who are here and who produced the documentary Punch 9 for Harold Washington, which we will be able to see a clip of this evening. So we'll now hear formal introductions from our speaker and moderator from Katie Frazier, a first-year student at the college involved with the IOP as a fellow ambassador. Please join me in welcoming Katie.
Hello, and welcome to the Institute of Politics' latest speaker series event, The Legacy of Chicago Mayor Harold Washington. My name is Katie Frazier, and I'm a first-year student from Dallas, Texas at the University of Chicago, studying political science and history. At the IOP, I currently serve as a Fellows Ambassador for Pritzker Fellow Joel Benenson. Tonight, we'll be discussing Harold Washington, Chicago's first black mayor and one of the nation's most historic and significant municipal leaders. Breaking through the unscrupulous morass of his party's machine politics in a racially charged campaign, Washington was elected in 1983 and served until his death on November 25, 1987. Tonight, we're joined by former Atlanta mayor, city councilwoman, and current IOP Pritzker Fellow, Keisha Lance Bottoms. Mayor Lance Bottoms was a pioneer in bringing equity to the city of Atlanta and was the first mayor in Atlanta's history to have served in all three branches of government, serving as a judge and city councilwoman before serving as mayor for 4 years. Mayor Lance Bottoms was also named Viacom's Bet Network Woman to Watch in 2018 and has been called the most prominent black female executive in the South and one of the few in the entire country by Politico magazine. We're also joined tonight by Cook County Circuit Court Chief Judge Tim Evans. Chief Judge Evans has brought extensive reforms to the court that are both innovative and compassionate, including critical changes to pretrial service operations and a new domestic violence courthouse. Earlier in his career, with the election of Harold Washington as mayor of Chicago in 1983, Chief Judge Evans assumed the coveted post of floor leader of the Chicago City Council, also chairing several major city council committees, including those on finance, budget, and health. Last but not least, Don Rose has many titles to his name. Columnist, political strategist, and champion for racial justice, Rose has spent his life making history in Chicago. He was the main strategist in former Mayor Burns' election as Chicago's first woman mayor, and helped elect the first black female and openly LGBTQ+ mayor in Chicago history, current Mayor Lori Lightfoot. Notably, Rose also had a critical leadership role in planning the protests at the 1968 Democratic Convention. He also served as one of Mayor Washington's political advisors, helping create immense changes toward reform. Tonight's discussion will be moderated by founding member and director of the UChicago Institute of Politics, host of the Axe Files, and former chief strategist and senior advisor to President Barack Obama, David Axelrod. He also covered Mayor Washington's first mayoral campaign for the Chicago Tribune before working on the mayor's successful reelection campaign in 1987. Please join me in welcoming our amazing speakers tonight as we speak on one of the biggest pioneers in Chicago history, former Mayor Harold Washington.
Thank you so much. I have to start off with a point of personal privilege because I'm on the stage, not just with our fantastic fellow, Mayor Bottoms, but also two people who are very formative in my life. Don Rose, who was a mentor of mine when I arrived here at the University of Chicago as a kind of student, half student, well, one quarter student, three quarter journalist. And I learned so much from him about journalism, about politics, about Chicago. And Tim Evans, who was representing the ward just north of here in the Kenwood Oakland community, and who played such an important role in this period of history that we're going to discuss. I feel like, you know, we just celebrated Passover, and there you ask this question, why is this night different than any other night? I think the question here is, why is Harold Washington different than any other mayor in the history of our city, and one of the luminescent mayors in the history and political figures in the history of our country, municipal leaders in the history of our country. To get a taste of that, we're going to have a piece of that wonderful documentary that Jen cited, Punch 9 for Harold Washington. So let's look at that, and then we'll pick up our discussion.
During the 70s and 80s, Chicago was the most racially segregated big city in the United States of America. Even though areas became predominantly black, there were white overseers who would really control the political power. There was a spirit of rebellion in the air.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Harold Washington.
I grew up in a segregated city, thinking that African Americans were never going to get the opportunity to rule and to govern. And Harold Washington changed all that forever.
I've watched the city of Chicago destroyed by petty politics, right, and bad government. Right. I have been urged by the earnest pleas of thousands of people to enter this race. Therefore, I hereby declare my candidacy.
Harold wasn't taken seriously. None of this was taken seriously.
How are you? I don't want to be mad if you do your homework.
I wasn't getting covered outside of the African American community.
Okay, the schedule is 9 o'clock.
We did not have any money, and we were pretty low in the polls.
We have 670,000 black registered voters in this city. And we have never argued that we want anything short of a coalition. But when you get right down to it, the votes are here. They're here. They're here.
There was a groundswell, and all you had to say is Harold was coming.
Good evening. This is the CBS Evening News. Dan Rather reporting. The results of Chicago's three-way race for the Democratic nomination for mayor today took many in that city and the nation by surprise.
I proudly and humbly accept the nomination as the Democratic candidate for mayor in 1980.
And now stands a good chance to become the first black mayor of the nation's second largest city.
People were beside themselves with excitement. I think a lot of people thought that City Hall was going to turn black overnight.
When Harold won in the primary,
some of my friends all decided that, hey, we got to get behind Epton, who was a Republican.
The vast majority of the Democratic machine became Republicans overnight.
How can I explain this? We were just going to have a low-key, small campaign, and now all of a sudden we have 1,000 volunteers. Where the day before we had 10.
On April 12th, Chicagoans must choose one of two men to lead this city.
Which one do you think should be Chicago's next mayor?
Well, it hurt.
it hurt. And we shouldn't be surprised. Nobody turns over power willingly.
And I think the Lord will forgive all of you for voting Republican just one day.
I've never seen an uglier, more racist campaign.
Someone had spray painted on the church and nigger die.
I've got the people of Chicago with me, and that's your fact. But I need your help.
Efton for mayor before it's too late.
I became so enraged, and I filled out a volunteer card. And then I was a poll watcher for Harold Washington. And we won our precinct. And my life changed forever.
Will you join this cavalcade of this massive coalition and help to clean up and redevelop our future communities? Will you help me? Will you join me? You want Harold?
I, Harold Washington, do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States.
It's a seismic event, a historic event.
Congratulations, Mr. Mayor.
Obama was a trailblazer, but Obama stood on Harold's shoulders.
I had just gotten out of college, and part of the reason I think I've been attracted to Chicago was reading about Harold Washington and the inspiration that African Americans across the country had taken from his election.
Thank you, thank you.
So what happens then is that some of his people said, we're going to cut them off at their knees, meaning us. Strip the chairmanships from them, strip the power from them, the patronage from them, take everything they got.
The battle went down as soon as Harold stepped in to City Hall, which became known as Council Wards.
The President recognizes Alderman Terrace.
I move we adjourn.
You've heard the motion. All in favor, signify by saying aye. Opposed, no. Council is adjourned.
After a 2.5-day honeymoon as mayor, Harold Washington's first meeting with the city council almost became a palace coup.
Too, but he ran away.
Mr. President, may we proceed with the business of this city council?
It was going to be all or nothing. We controlled the votes.
When will you recognize us, sir?
You're out of order, Mr. Doyle.
When will you this whole procedure is out of order, the way you're conducting it, Chief?
There were a lot of things that Mayor Washington wanted to do that we blocked. His appointments, who came up, we didn't pass them.
Shut it up! Tell him again! You're afraid of the truth!
The political opposition was basically trying to keep the government from operating. The form of political terrorism, you know, it's the hostage taking with the entire city of Chicago, the hostage.
They called it Beirut on the Lake. I mean, in national newspapers. It was ugly.
Your point of order is recognized, sir. The clerk will proceed.
It was a test of wills. It was a struggle for the soul of Chicago.
It was about race, but it was more about power.
It was about power.
You opened the door to folks in a way that it will never be shut again.
If a historian were to have written a brief account of your administration and what you achieved, what would you hope he would write?
He would probably say this. That was a turning point. That was a turning point.
Another hand for the producers of the. Thank you for making it. Thank you for making it available. So much to unpack there. But Don, let's go back to the beginning of this story. One of the you have too many credentials to include in one introduction, but one of them was that you were also the press secretary for Dr. King, when he came to Chicago in 1966 to lead marches against housing discrimination, and not successfully. He was he came head to head with a very deft Mayor Daley, who was a leader of the Democratic organization, mayor of the city, and he left without achieving all that much. But your involvement in politics was very much tied to the issue of civil rights.
Yeah.
Describe Chicago politically in the years in the 70s, from the time that in the last years of Mayor Daley through the momentous years that followed, and how much did race define all of those that politics?
Well, I think in order to understand the great impact of Harold, it was more than just an ordinary political victory between two sides, or even internecine white fight in the Democratic Party. You have to understand the Daley machine, which extended. There was a Democratic machine that started in the 30s. And by the time Daley took it over, he completely controlled the city, the jobs. He was head of the party, and he was head of the government. And there was a patronage system through which he controlled elections and controlled communities. And
jobs and contracts.
Pardon me?
Jobs and contracts.
Yeah, jobs and contrast and everything. He even had eventually brought the private sector in to provide jobs and contracts for his followers. I don't know if you've read about the Madigan case, where Madigan is having getting jobs for people in Commonwealth Edison. That was kind of a model that was begun by Daley, where he brought in all of the downtown businessmen and had them provide jobs to strengthen the economics of his machine. And part of his job was to keep the city segregated. It was to keep the Loop white and the surrounding areas white. And this was the devil's bargain that he made after being elected the first time in 1955. And he made the devil's bargain with LaSalle Street and State Street that he would do everything he could to keep the city white. And he used every instrumentality of government, the schools, the police department, the planning department. Every instrumentality of government was used to maintain segregation in the city. He had his own controlled handful of black aldermen that did the work for him. There was all kinds of names that were used for people like that. I don't need to repeat them. But he was the oppressor, except for those who went along with him. And he would provide jobs, and had his Timuel Black came up with the term plantation politics, and he had his overlords of the plantation who were him.
Let me, because I want to get everybody else into the conversation. Tim, you were a product of the Democratic organization, of what Don refers to as the Daley machine, as was Harold Washington. Tell me what it was like as a young alderman and as part of this organization. What were the expectations of you, and how hard were how hard was entry into politics without the imprimatur of this machine?
Well, it's an interesting question and a fair question. Interesting because the Daley machine started with the help of African Americans. Congressman Dawson.
Yes, here from this area.
Yeah, made it possible for Daley to be elected in 1955. And so in answer to your question, the Harold Washingtons, the Tim Evans, the Ralph Metcalf who preceded mm-hmm. Harold, we all ended up breaking from that machine.
Preceded Harold in Congress, yes. That's
right. We thought of it as a vehicle to get into a way to change things for the community. And I would put it this way, and I think Harold would have as well. The approach to problem solving was to be efficient, to be open, and to be honest. And for our community, we added to that to be fair and to use as a vehicle to change things. It had to be a vehicle to change things. And we thought, well, these people who look down on blacks, who look down on minorities, who look down on people who've immigrated to the community, they don't know us, and that's the reason they're looking down on us. And we thought, well, as soon as the light shines and they see the talent and capability that we have, they're going to treat us just like other citizens would be treated.
How'd that work out?
It didn't work out too well. First, Ralph Metcalf, who had been a Daley favorite, had friends who were brutalized by the police department, Daley's police department, and that led to his break. Harold Washington was in the Third Ward where Ralph Metcalf was the leader, and Harold broke. When Harold broke, the rest of us thought, well, this is the way to do it. This is the vehicle. We tried to change that vehicle. It didn't change, and we had to move out to change it from the outside in. And that's the way we looked at it. When Harold decided that he would run in 1977, before 82 and 83, it was because of the way the Daley machine treated another African-American who had a kind of titular position as president pro tem, the guy who took the mayor's seat when the mayor went to the bathroom. Well, when Mayor Daley died, they thought it would at least give him the opportunity to step into that position as the interim mayor. The Daley people locked the door. His name was Wilson Frost. He was alderman. They locked the door so Wilson Frost couldn't get in. And I always thought that was one of the things that caused Harold to run in 1977.
Well, let me pick this back up with Donna. And Mayor, you have a unique perspective and I want to ask you about that for a second, but just on this 1977 point, everybody, obviously Harold Washington made history in 1983, but there were reverberations that were obvious in 77. Yeah. And yeah. I think you were involved in that, weren't you, in his campaign in 77?
Oh, yeah, I was his political consultant.
So Mayor Daley had died.
And Mayor Daley died. And
special election.
Right, special election came up. And Harold ran, and one of the well-known racist aldermen, Roman Puchinsky, also ran. And
The mayor, the designee of the...
I'm sorry. And
Mike Blandick, the designee
Michael Blandick, who was the interim, turned out to be the interim mayor. A very short interim. We beat him a couple of years
later.
We'll
get to that.
But we go into, I don't know how much of this history is
relevant. Just on this,
Harold, when he first ran in that race, was defeated. He came in third. Roman Puchinsky came in second, and Michael Blandick became the interim mayor. This was a pattern that was occurring in the country. The black mayors at that time, the people who were elected mayor, Richard Hatcher and Gary, I forgot the man's name, in Cleveland, and
Carl
so on.
Stokes.
Different Stokes for different folk. all ran once before and lost before winning. And this was the pattern at that time. And In this first race, he only carried three or four wards, which had been generally independent African-American wards. They elected independent aldermen. By independent, I mean those were not affiliated with the old Chicago machine.
But let me just put a button on that piece of it. That alone, the fact that, and Tim, you know this, that the fact that Harold Washington could carry, I think it was actually five black wards back in 77, was really kind of a breakthrough thing, that a candidate for mayor running against the Democratic organization, a black candidate, could take these wards that had been sort of faithful adherents, even if they had some independent inclination, some of these wards on the South Side, middle class wards on the South Side. But it indicated that there was this base. Don, you'd worked on other campaigns earlier that suggested that as well.
Well, but Mayor, of the aldermen who won those independent wards.
Yes, yeah. Mayor, you were a kid in Atlanta when all this Harold Washington stuff was happening. Atlanta had already elected not one but two black mayors by the time Washington got elected. How aware were you of what was going on in Chicago? And I know you have a lot of ties to the city. And what did his election as the mayor of the second largest city in the country mean?
Well, I was born in 1970. Maynard Jackson was elected mayor of Atlanta, I believe, in 1972. So I'm a part of what President Obama often calls the Joshua generation. So I am a post-civil rights baby in Atlanta, not knowing anything other than black mayors. It was Maynard Jackson, followed by Ambassador Young, but I have a very large family in Chicago. And I remembered, as my dad would talk to his family, all of the chatter was about Harold Washington was going to be the mayor of Chicago. And I remember thinking, well, why is that a big deal? Because I just assumed everybody had a black mayor in their city. And the summer of 1986, I came to stay with my grandmother. Her house is at 87th and South Calumet. And Harold Washington was coming to the neighborhood. He was coming to the street. And she made us go stand outside on the sidewalk. And all the other neighbors lined up on the sidewalk. And I'm going, it's just the mayor. But and my grandmother's house is a split level house. And, you know, you've been in the houses. I don't know if this is in outside of black people's houses, but there were the pictures of Dr. King, Robert Kennedy, John F. Kennedy, and Jesus.
Yeah.
But in that's my right. grandmother.
In which order are they?
Well, Jesus was in the front room and they were in the den. But in my grandmother's house in the kitchen, just above the stairway going upstairs, there was this huge framed picture of Harold Washington. And so I knew it was extraordinary. And you know, I came to learn that Chicago had never had a black mayor, and I've learned so much more. And even the parallels just in watching and what I've watched about the election to how ugly that race was compared with Maynard Jackson's first race and how people were supposed to be afraid to go and vote for this black guy as mayor. So I came to appreciate the fact that my grandmother made me stand on the sidewalk to see him coming to the neighborhood, and just the excitement and energy and the fact that Jesus had been replaced with Harold Washington. I quickly learned it was a really big deal.
Yeah, that is a big deal.
Yeah.
Tim, talk about the run-up to the 1983 election, because now I'm going to offer a little testimonial. I was covering that race, and I was doing a scene setter in the summer of 1982. And I went to see Harold at his congressional office. And he had been elected, as you guys referenced, in 1978 when Ralph Metcalf died. He defeated the organization to win that race, the Democratic machine to win that race. And he came into this meeting. He said, what do you want? And I said, well, I'm doing the scene setter on the mayoral race, and you know, a lot of people are talking about you running. You know, and I want to, he said, can we talk off the record? I said, yeah. He said, Axelrod, you know what it's like to be a congressman? And I said, obviously not. And he said, well, you can, you know, there are good things you can do. They treat you like a king. You can come and go as you please. He said, mayor's like a real job. He said, why would I do that to myself? He said, but, he said, there are a lot of people in the community, Don, you'll remember this, you both guys will, there were these plebiscites that were being held to determine who should run as the black candidate in 1983 against Mayor Byrne, and ultimately it was Byrne and Daley, Richard Daley, the son of the late mayor. And he was, it was like, you know, 3,006 for Harold, 10 for the next person. Yeah. And he said, so they're having these votes, and a lot of people are interested in me running. And I just keep telling him, if you can, I think he said, I recall he said, if you could register 80,000 voters by November 1st, black new voters in the community, if you can raise $500,000, he said, then we're serious, then I'll think about it. He said, they'll never, no, I don't think anybody's going to be able to do that. And the next time I saw him was over at that, what was then, I think the 50th of the Lake Motel or something over there on, here in Hyde Park, and he was announcing his candidacy, and he saw me and he pulled me aside. He said, they did it. What could I do? I kind of have to do it. Now he ended up, of course, loving it, but what was it?
That's exactly right. I mean, he was perfectly happy as a congressman. But as I look back on it, it seemed to me that it was along the lines of inevitability. But at the time that it was happening, no way. He had the top position that any black politician had had in the country since after Abraham Lincoln died. Nobody had ever been anything higher than a congressman. He had made it. And when he said, well, register me some votes, 80,000 or whatever it was, he never guessed that they would do that. They registered 263,000. He said, well, you got to have enough money to run. And he had no idea that the business community would come together to raise that money, much more than he ever guessed would be there.
The black business.
The black business people. A guy by the name of Ed Gardner was among the first. Dempsey Travis, George Johnson, all the Johnsons.
Yeah, they there were a number of Johnsons money. Who were successful businessmen.
Absolutely. And so, and I put it this way, in biblical terms, in Luke, I think it's Luke 12, 48, it said, to whom much is given, much is required. He couldn't say no. And it was
I can
required.
See that Tim has Jesus in his proper place.
See, now, and many of these black businessmen, not all of them, but many of them were in the pocket of the Daley machine all those years before. They did not help him when he first ran for office in 77.
So what made this moment, Don? What made this moment, what made it possible? Why were people willing to break away? Why were people gravitating to him?
Well, that has to do, I think, with the incumbent at the time.
Who you also helped elect.
Yes.
It must be said. Jane Byrne defeated the machine in 1979, became the first woman mayor of Chicago.
Yes. Jane Byrne became the first woman mayor of Chicago, largely with the help of the black community, which we thought at the time, you know, people asked me, you know, why did you run Byrne's campaign? It seemed like a good idea at the time.
Because she ended up governing in a much different way than you and she promised.
Oh, exactly. And but what was significant was the Byrne campaign was the first time the black community had successfully rebelled against the machine. And that is what gave hope when Byrne fired some black heads of the school board and the CHA board and replaced them with white racists because she felt that that was the vote she needed, that the blacks would stay on the plantation and go along with her. She made a little error there.
Yeah.
Anyway, they became enraged.
Yeah,
the fact that they had once rebelled and now had the power to elect another mayor, this one black, who had proven that he was not one of the Toms who the mayor might have had replacing him, that gave them hope and spirit. And
I want to hold up this button, which you probably can't see, but it is a replica of the campaign button that I think every black person in Chicago was wearing in 1983, and it started off as a smattering. And I wrote a column about this for the Tribune at the time. And more and more and more people were wearing these buttons, and it's a sunrise. Yeah. And it has significant meaning because I think that for a whole bunch of citizens in this city who didn't feel like they had a place at the table, this was a declaration that we are a full participants in the politics of this city. Anyway, Tim, I cut you off.
Yeah, I would like to add that even when Harold announced, and you saw the energy that obviously was taking place during the announcement, many people thought, well, this is going to be just like 1977. We'd like to see Harold do it. But he didn't have any money, and he didn't have the votes, and nobody thought this was really possible. But the first debate between Byrne and Daley and this guy named Harold Washington, he wiped the floor with them.
That's Daley the son we're talking about there.
Yeah. Daley the son, yeah.
And that's when people saw that it could be done. And it wasn't just the black community. It was the community that had come awake on the lakefront and the Hyde Park Kenwood community. And it was some of those blacks who said, well, it'll never be done. They said, yeah, maybe this guy could do it.
Yeah, and we should point out to our students that at that time, it was pre-cable television, or more or less. And the Chicago station simulcast these debates. They had huge, huge audiences. And so, the fact that Harold Washington dominated these debates with humor and incisiveness and
intelligent,
yeah,
and facts,
yeah,
he
bowled him over. His very first line stunned the city. I'm running for mayor because Jane Byrne is destroying this city. He got their attention.
Yes, he did. So he wins the primary, as was related in this wonderful documentary. And the assumption in Chicago was, if you're the Democratic nominee, you're elected. You're elected, and it very quickly turned out not to be the case. Tim, let me ask Don, actually. What was your presumption did you presume that Harold was elected when he was nominated, or did you anticipate what we saw?
Initially, I anticipated he was going to make it. Then I saw all the rest of the Democratic, the white, with two or three exceptions, the white Democratic committeemen led by Roman Puchinsky and Ed Kelly, if you remember those names.
Probably not.
Decided that they were going to become Republicans. And this carried on even after he won. This rebellion of the whites is what caused council wars.
We
discovered that the city was really a weak mayor, strong council system.
We'll get to that, but just I just want to ask Tim one question about this. The Democratic organization was fairly coherent. There'd be ruptures in it from time to time. Factions, ethnic factions would fight and everything. Yeah. At that juncture when Harold got nominated, what were the conversations like between you and your fellow Democratic committee men, black and white?
It was interesting. As David says, in the past, if the Democratic Party strayed anybody from it, I mean, you were a persona non grata. You were not viewed as anything that could ever come back again.
Well, and in the daily years, punished.
Absolutely. You would lose your patronage. You would lose everything that you thought you could count on if you didn't follow the line. And so initially, I thought, well, whoever they choose to be the Republican nominee is going to be an also-ran. That always is the way it is in Chicago and in Cook County. If you are a Democrat, you're going to win if you won the primary. And if you're a Republican, you're just going to be an also-ran. And also, the Republican who had been chosen was a moderate Republican from the Hyde Park area.
Yes.
He was not a racist. He was not known as somebody who would say, vote for us until it's too late. That was
never
anything.
You could see he looked like a rabbinical student, or a rabbi, actually.
Yeah, nobody expected that at all from Epton. Yeah, and all of a sudden, we looked around, and he was the leader of a mob against Harold Washington. And all that did was inspire the independent community to work even harder.
And were you, as a committeeman, as a member, I mean, was there an attitude among your peers, hey, we played the game all those years, and now one of our community gets nominated, and you're going to walk away from us?
Well, we had this happen just before the primary. Sawyer and I had our disagreements, but we agreed, along with one other ward committeeman from the 5th Ward, Dobry, that we would support Harold even before the primary. We came out and we told the Sun-Times, this is a fellow from our community, he has all the capability, and we're going to support him. So we were beginning to get that look from our colleagues, the other Democratic ward committee. How could you do something like that, Tim? You know, they're gonna cut you off. You're gonna be outcast. We didn't care, because we thought Harold could do it. And so it did not surprise us when we saw other wards lining up with Epton. I always thought power was what they were after, but they would use race in order to get it. I never thought that most of these guys were actually racist, because I had seen them interact with others from our community, not in a racist way, but they used race. They thought, they let the people think that somehow Harold, as the first elected African-American mayor, was going to treat people like he had been treated, when all he wanted to do was be fair to everybody. And he kept saying, I'm going to be so fair to you, if you don't welcome me with my fairness, I will find you and I will give you the fairness anyway. that's the way he felt. And that was true, whether it was something relatively minor, like sidewalks for all the citizens.
Vaulted sidewalks.
Yeah. People came to me and they said, well, Tim, since you helped Harold, you're going to get all the new sidewalk money, right? I said, no, I'm only going to get 1/50th of it. And the rest of it is going to be spread around fairly. And that's exactly the way he saw it. He saw not abandoning downtown, but everything he did from downtown, he did for the community as well. He said, okay, I'm going to save the Chicago Theater. We're going to rebuild the Loop. And so he invested there. But he said also, I'm going to reinvest in the Regal Theater on the South Side. He said, you know, O'Hare needs to be fixed up. We need a new annex at O'Hare. And so he said, I'm going to invest money in O'Hare, but I'm also going to invest in inner city Chicago. I'm going to do the same thing for McCormick Place. And he said, you know, I would like to have a first-class library. First class. We had no idea it was going to be named after him. But he wanted to do that for all the citizens, not for any segment of our society, but the whole society.
We're gonna take some questions in a few minutes, so if anyone has them, you can line up behind that microphone. Mayor, Don referenced the council wars, and Tim was right in the middle of it as the floor leader for Harold Washington. First of all, I'm sure you can't imagine a city with 50 aldermen. That has to be a mayor's nightmare. Right there. But council wars became kind of a national thing, and in some ways a forerunner of maybe what we saw later in our history when we elected the first black president, race being used to organize power. But how do you, when you hear all of this conversation, how do you see it? How do you see it in history?
Yeah, it's fascinating. One, 50 aldermen. You compare that with Atlanta, there are 12 council members, 3 at-large members, and a president without a vote. So all you need are 8 votes to get anything done in Atlanta. And then,
It's too late to move, Judge.
Completely different beast, but... You know, when you think about Chicago politics, I think that it really has been a playbook for people who want to mobilize across the country, good, bad, and indifferent. I think there are so many lessons in Harold Washington's leadership and how bold and unapologetic he was and just the expectations that our communities would have. But you know, city councils can be difficult, but extremely difficult when they actually do have power. Yeah. So when our new mayor was elected, and I'm sure some of our council members didn't like it, I said, he came from city council. I said, the only thing you now have in common with city council is that you park in the same garage. Because the mayor is very strong in Atlanta, but clearly that's a very different beast in Chicago.
You know, you talk about Chicago becoming a model and so on. Don, put in context the importance of Mayor Washington to the political development in Chicago. And nationally, and specifically, you know, I'm of the mind that no, and I said it here, I think no Harold Washington, there may not have been a Barack Obama because it was the black political community that provided a political base for him when he ran for the United States Senate. I think he strongly believed that as well.
Oh, yeah. Well, coming from this community, particularly, that's why he moved into this community. Because this was still a community, even after Harold died, it was the community that was independent, that did not go along with the machine, and you did not have to get in line in any of the 48 other wards that he might have tried to move into. And the fact that he came from a community that had developed its independent power is why he chose the neighborhood. He chose the church carefully he wanted to go to. It was all well-planned based on what he saw with Harold Washington, who lived not far from here.
Yeah, and there the political base that Harold, I mean, once that base was created, Tim, you know, Carol Moses Brown got elected to the United States Senate in 1992.
Right.
And, you know, 12 years later, Obama got elected, and you started seeing the black community voting very strategically in a way that wasn't true before, and in larger numbers.
That is absolutely true, and it's interesting. At one point when President Obama was first elected, I got a call from somebody from the New York Times in New York, and they said, well, tell us a little bit about Barack Obama and in the Harold Washington community when he was an organizer.
Yeah.
I said, oh, well, I didn't know him. I had no idea he'd become president. They said, oh, sure you did. And I said, what do you mean? And they sent me a picture. He had come to my office as an organizer, and he brought the press with him, and he was representing at that time people from Ardgill Gardens. I remember the meeting quite well, but I just didn't recognize it was the same guy.
He probably didn't identify himself as the future president.
No. Yeah. And then in several of the programs that showed his maturation here in Chicago, they have this picture, and I'm sitting at my desk in my three-piece suit, and he's sitting on the floor with these people from Ardgill Gardens, like I'm instructing him, you know. But he was mesmerized about what Harold had done here, and he wanted to do the same for the people. At least I didn't get the impression he was seeking to be president or anything like that. Yeah. He just wanted to be a part of helping people. He saw what Harold was able to do, and he wanted to be a part of it.
Yeah. And he turned out to be a good organizer, because an organizer's job is not to impress you with him, but to let the people from the community speak to you and him recess, even though he has coached them a lot.
And we should point out the picture in the documentary that we saw was the only picture that you'll find, because he only met Harold Washington once when he organized a demonstration. Essentially, he organized the community to protest the mayor's visit to a, because they wanted, I think they wanted to bring a school or something to the area. So he never, I always often wonder what it would have been like if the two of them had had the chance to know each other. I suspect they would have been very, very close. But let's take some questions.
Hello, my name's Felix. I'm a fourth year undergrad here studying political science. My question is, you know, a lot of this is, you know, there's the sense that Harold Washington was a turning point in the history of Chicago. And I was more interested in this kind of counterfactual where, like, imagine if Harold Washington hadn't died in office. Imagine if he had served, say, as long as the first Daley, or maybe not that long, but pretty long. How do you think the history of Chicago would be different today?
Well, if I could comment on that, I would say we would be much further along. And I'll tell you why I believe that to be the case. The eyes and ears for Harold Washington were in the community. He organized the community residents to let him know what was needed. So in the senior citizen communities, he had senior citizens who wanted to bring their concerns to him. In the community like this, an intellectual community, young people's community, there's no way you wouldn't have known Harold Washington had the time come, because he would have listened to you. You would have said, well, Kel, you know what? I'm a fourth year student at the University of Chicago, and we would like to have this, that, and the other from this guy by the name of David Axelrod. And he would have made sure that David Axelrod would have presented it. That was the way he was. He was responsive to what was needed. And so I just think we'd be much further along than we are right now. I certainly don't think we'd be suffering from the crime that is associated with communities that were the subject of disinvestment, because I think he was investing heavily in the communities. That's what he thought this was all about, to raise the money and to get that money back into the communities where you would have the kind of educational facilities you needed, where there would be the opportunity to learn, to earn a living, and opening up and broaden the base of opportunity. That's what he was all about.
Can we take another?
I can add just one little thing to that. Very specifically, Harold was the first mayor to, in his budget, redirect money out to the communities.
Exactly right.
Particularly the black communities. And he met opposition in executing it when he had the council going against him. And had he not died in office and was able to actually execute it, we might have had a significantly, very significantly different South and West Side.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Connor Lee. I'm a second year student here at UChicago. My question is, what do you think was the single most important or impactful initiative that Harold Washington championed while he was mayor?
A single no.
I can give you two. I'm sure Tim has some others. One was the effort to redirect some of the money, which until now, with Lightfoot, has never really been tried, even though she has not done it fully. The other great thing, and the thing that really reformed Chicago, was the elimination of patronage. I don't know if you've ever heard of the Shachtman decree.
I don't think we have time to go into the
patronage.
Whole.
Harold was the first mayor who went into into court and swore fealty to the patronage, to the Shachtman decree ending patronage. And he used to stomp on his foot. It's dead, dead, dead. The end of patronage was the beginning of the new Chicago.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Steve Saltzman. I graduated from the law school before many of you were born. I have a really easy question. What needs to happen? What do we need to do in Chicago to get the next Harold Washington as our mayor?
Well, that's a tough one.
And it's almost an unfair one because...
I think that there are talented, capable, able people who could move this city forward, and I'm convinced that we have the talent to do that. But the combination that made up Harold Washington, I think it's hard to duplicate that again readily. He was state representative, state senator, congressman, all before he became mayor. And he had the various communities we've talked about, but he also had the nationalistic community, the Conrad Wurls and the Robert Starks and all of those people. And he died at the age of 65, so, and having served only 4.5 years, you could see how old he was by the time he had the opportunity to serve. So I think the talent is here in this city to do it, but I think it's going to take, we can't wait for one combination like Harold Washington. I think there's a role for all of us to play in producing that which the Harold Washington syndrome can produce. I think he believed, for example, that education was the way out, that no community could survive without a good educational base, along with one that responded to the community and produced what the community needed. I can recall, for example, we were in Beijing. We were establishing a sister city relationship between Shenyang and Chicago. And we happened to be in Tiananmen Square, where Mao Zedong has the mausoleum. And Harold was walking along, as we all were, and he was not talking to me particularly, but he just said, wow, this is the way they remember their leader. He said, I wonder how they will remember me. And I think of it, Harold Washington College, the Harold Washington the library, the best, in my view, the most comprehensive community library in this nation, you know? I think that is the way he envisioned this city moving forward, with an educated base where all of the people had a chance to develop the full opportunities that each community needed to have developed. And we shouldn't be waiting for one more Harold Washington. We should each see a piece of Harold Washington, each one of us. Mm-hmm. I think that's a much better way to do it.
And I think also just the inspiration that leaders like Harold Washington provided for the next generation like me, that you, when you run for office, you obviously have a set of goals, but I think you want to make sure that everything that you do is long lasting, and that when people call your name, they will remember that you did something special and important and impactful for a community. And I think Harold Washington, for me anyway, has been the epitome of that. That this is a man that's so was so beloved by the community that people came out of their houses just to see him drive down the street, just to see him exit a car, because he represented so much hope and inspiration, and that's a great model for any leader.
He took a lot of that from Atlanta, by the way. Maynard Jackson was a very good friend of his, and his approach to sharing contractual opportunities came from Atlanta, where minorities would now get a piece of that contractual business, and women would get a piece of that contractual business. That all came from Atlanta, from Maynard Jackson.
And the irony of it, when Maynard Jackson finished his first two terms as mayor, he could not get a job in Atlanta.
Wow.
No law firm in Atlanta would offer him a job, and he moved to Chicago to work with a law firm.
Don, I don't know if you remember, I'm sure you were in the office when Jane Byrne came back, ran against Harold Washington in the primary in 1987. It was a tougher race than it should have been. We were sitting in in his inner office. He was going to have a press conference. And he asked, and I think he asked you, he said, what percentage of the white vote did we get? And you said 21%.
And 16.
And he said, and he was sort of, he kind of, that took him aback. And you said, well, you know, you only got 8 last time, so we're making progress. And he said, you know, I've really tried to be a great mayor for everybody in the city. I probably spent 70% of my time in the white community. And we get, you know, whether it's 16 or 21, we get that and we're happy. And he just kind of shrugged and he said, ain't it a bitch to be a black man in the land of the free and the home of the brave? Mm-hmm. And but then he cheerfully went out and did battle. And the thing that is important here is through all these pitched battles, when Harold Washington died, he would lie in state at City Hall, and you'll remember this. And there were lines all around City Hall.
Absolutely.
To view him day and night. And those lines were white people, black people, Hispanic people, Asian people. And you realize that the tragedy is he died 7 months after he was reelected, that he had finally achieved what he wanted to achieve. The city had finally accepted him as their mayor, as the mayor of the whole city. And people felt they identified with him, and he died suddenly and missed the opportunity to take advantage of that. You only had control of the city council, Tim, for 2 years.
Right.
That's right. And we tried to get as much done within that 2-year period. He kept saying to all of us, look, I'm going to be your mayor for 20 years. And so we weren't worried about him.
Should have made him sign something.
I should have done more than that. I was telling the mayor, I was with him about an hour before he died. He was dedicating housing in this community, not far from here. And he was in high spirits. He was always, playing games with us. And they brought out the shovels and they brought out the hard hats. And some of us, we wanted to be in the picture with the mayor. So I put on my hat and my hard hat, looking ridiculous. I had an afro at that time, and trying to put a hard hat over my afro made me look ridiculous. But while I was putting on the hat and trying to get my shovel, I looked around, and Mayor Washington was putting dirt already in my shovel. And I said, okay, I'm going to put some in your shovel. So, he was effervescent even to the day he died.
Yeah.
And I just, it shocked me, and you're absolutely right. There were lines and lines around City Hall, not only around City Hall, when we were on the way to his funeral. Every community that we went through, the people you were talking about, people standing out to watch, they were applauding him.
Mm. Yeah.
All the way. And it was every segment of our society, the Latinx community, the African-American community, but also the Caucasian-American community and the Asian-American community. I mean, he had pulled us together.
Yeah.
And I just, in answer to our friend's question, I just think he would have been able to get us much further along the line. I'm not trying to say this would have been Perfectionville. I'm not trying to say that. But I just think he had the city moving in the right direction, and everybody was working with him at the time.
Yeah. Don, final thought?
Harold was an inspirational leader like no one other than John Kennedy. He had that quality, and it took a death to bring it all together.
Yeah, yeah.
I looked upon him like a black Santa Claus, you know? I mean, everywhere he went, he had that big smile, and it didn't matter who you were, if there's dance music on, he was gonna dance right with you.
Yeah.
And you know, and of course, if there was food around, he was going to eat all that food. It was great.
But he also, and we should point out, and then we should end, when it was time to battle, he was a battler, and he sort of took joy in the fight as well. He felt strongly about what he was fighting for, never backed up. I mean, and I think that also earned him respect.
Absolutely.
From people in the city. This is a city of broad shoulders.
Yeah. He could tell his great opponent, Edward Oleak, little things like, you're going to wind up with a mouthful of knuckles.
Yeah. 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 No, it was a time. And it's such a pleasure to be able to share some of these memories with all of you and with a successor in the tradition of Harold Washington. So thank you all, and thank you for your questions and for being here tonight.